Studio check.
Frequencies check.
We are live on air.
You are listening to The In Fact, blessing the airwaves. Take the journey into the world of sports, news, entertainment, while embracing the hottest beats on the planet. Rocking the mind, body, and soul. Energy, electricity, and a splash of controversy. Now, without further ado, it's our pleasure to bring to you
the biggest show in the world.
The biggest show in the world.
The biggest show in the world. The SBTV Nation.
It's the treatment of house. Everything is today. As we get started, we got college basketball on tap. I'm here with my boy, the Mad Hatter. What's going on, people?
Okay, this feels like my theme song. Feels like the SBTV theme song, Dream. I love this track. It's like the old faithful. You just go right to it. 40 Bars of Terror by Jadakiss, kid. The champ is here, Dream.
No doubt. Okay, what's going on as we are into the All-Star weekend in the NBA? A lot of good things going on as far as the NBA is concerned. Couple little games last night. Couple little storylines. The biggest storyline going on is obviously Kevin Durant, Russell Westbrook's relationship.
Well, for what it is, anyway.
For what it is. Just interested in seeing how those dynamics play out on the court on Sunday. So kind of a good storyline for the NBA as far as their All-Star game and getting a little buzz created there, because people definitely are going to be tuned in to taking a look at what transpires in the game and how these two seem to play and act on the court with each other.
I think they'll be just fine, Dream.
Oh, no doubt they'll be just fine. But I think you got to wonder, you know, will Westbrook pass the ball? You know,
oh, stuff like that. Okay. All right. Yeah, we got to see what's going to go on with that. And there's a bunch of props as far as, you know, player totals, team totals, and all that kind of stuff with the NBA All-Star game. So I might have to dive right in and kind of take a look at it.
Yeah, it looks to be interesting. Now, I don't get involved in, you guys know, I rarely ever get involved in any All-Star, any kind of game where it's for fun. I just don't get involved in that. You know, I don't, as far as financials concern, I don't think it's, you know, worth your money, because I don't think you're getting a full effort. However, Hat has mentioned some prop situations that might be interesting to look at from that standpoint. So you might want to go there if you want to look at, you know, because some things we kind of have an idea are going to happen as far as, you know, points scored and whatever have you. So that you might want to look at, but we can get a little bit of that probably tomorrow.
I think my boy is going to have a big load on his back, considering the fact that most of the East is not that good, Dream.
Yeah, but the West doesn't play great defense. It's a fun, you know how it works. It's a fun game. The West is going to give up points. You know how it works. They'll find a way to make it entertaining and somewhat competitive.
Yeah, I get it. But what I'm saying is that my boy might go crazy tomorrow night when they play.
I don't know about that.
You don't think so?
I don't know. I mean, we'll see. I don't know about that. We haven't really talked about the East lineup, to be honest.
Because it's shaky, man. It's a little shaky. I mean, Jimmy Butler, I think, is definitely one of the best out there, honestly. Okay. And I really think that between Jimmy Butler and Kawhi Leonard, I think they're underrated, Dream.
Well, I don't think Kawhi Leonard is.
You think that they think of him as one of the elite at this point?
Kawhi?
Yeah.
Definitely.
You think so, huh?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
I don't hear as much about him, to be honest with you. Like,
I hear a ton about Kawhi. Are you kidding me?
What about his endorsement deals and stuff like that, though?
Well, no, that he does not have going on. But, I mean, you got to, you know, NBA is very, it's funny, the guys that get endorsement deals in the NBA and the people you see on TV as far as commercials are concerned and representing products, it's kind of minuscule when you think about that in the NBA. I mean, you got LeBron.
Yep.
You know, you got Chris Paul doing his thing with, you know, with one of the insurance companies. I forget which insurance company it is, but you got Chris Paul. Yep. And then you've got the Blake. Other big man who they have.
You got Blake.
Blake's got a few. You're right. And then you have Steph Curry had those, but I don't see those anymore. The Steph Curry commercials seem like after they fell off last year, they stopped running those commercials.
The reason, well, number one, he fell off. Number two is that he didn't have too many nice things to say about the president of the United States dream. So you know what? That's why they ain't feeling it. That's it.
By the way, that commercial had nothing to do with that. The guy who he had the issue with the president was for the Under Armour CEO or president or whatever. But I'm talking about he was doing State Farm commercials or some insurance company commercial prior to that.
Yeah, got it. And he does Gatorade too.
Does Gatorade too. Now, as we look at the Eastern Conference All-Star, the lineup, you're talking about Kyrie Irving, DeMar DeRozan, LeBron James, Jimmy Butler.
And Kyrie, right?
I said Kyrie. Yep, Kyrie's there. This dude's name is ridiculous.
Fantasy
Check
players.
Out the guy from Milwaukee.
Check out that cat. Exactly. He always has like 100 fantasy points, man. He's crazy.
Yeah, no doubt. Antetokounmpo. Sorry, guys. I'm Giannis. I'm just going to call him Giannis.
Yes.
Because the last name is just beyond me, and I'm sorry about that. But those are the starters. And then as far as reserves are concerned, you're looking at Isaiah Thomas, John Wall, Carmelo Anthony, Kyle Lowry, Paul George, Kemba Walker, and Paul Millsap. So, I mean, the East – I mean, these guys are going to get some points, Hat.
Yeah, a little bit.
You know, these guys are going to get some points. Isaiah Thomas, you talk about an underrated player. Isaiah Thomas is extremely underrated, in my opinion.
Yeah, I agree with you on that. Big time. Green, it's college basketball.
No doubt. Right definitely now. College basketball. But just want to just talk a little bit about the All-Star for a minute. College basketball is in full effect. Before we go in there, a couple of quick notes, gang. I don't know if you guys are aware of this or even if you care, but I do need to talk about, first of all, Revis is released on bond in the NFL.
Good for him.
All right. Well, I'm sure there's going to be a whole bunch more coming from him out of that camp with the story and what had all transpired. So we will keep our eye on that. Malcolm Floyd begins a 24-day jail sentence in Arizona. This for, you know, related to his DUI arrest and all that went down with that. That goes down starting today. And Trent Richardson, arrested and domestic violence. Don't know exactly what went down there. There's not a lot of information, but he was arrested in Alabama on domestic violence issues. So that's what's going on as far as NFL is concerned.
Got it, man. Well, you know what? The NFL always got a little something going on, huh, Dream?
Something going on. As far as last night game, we recap. Yale goes down.
Yeah, they did. Good call on your part.
Yale goes down. You know, this Yale team, I'm sorry, they're not who they were last year.
No, of course not.
Like I said, I don't like their poise. I don't like the way they handle being down. They don't play well from behind. They're a type of team that needs a lead, and they play well when they're in front, but don't seem to play well when they're behind. And Princeton jumped out all over them and got the job done.
Got it done, man. So, you know what? Hey, big ups to Princeton right now. I mean, I think Deke's pick sent me a 7,000-1 shot for Princeton for the NCAA tournament because, you know what, they got Princeton winning the Ivy League and moving on, Dream. So, you know what, hey, the Ivy League has always done good in the tournament.
Ivy League has done good in the tournament. I think it's once again, we talk about the Kumite style of the basketball tournament, and we talk about teams who are not used to playing these teams that play a different type of basketball than some of the bigger teams are accustomed to can come in and get snuck.
Yeah, exactly. Well, you know, because the Princeton Tigers right now are 9-0 in conference play in the Ivy League. And I mean, you know, when you look at the Yale Bulldogs, I mean, they're missing Sears, the big man. They're also missing Mekhi Mason, who went down with the foot injury dream. I mean, that's a huge loss. I mean, he lit up Baylor last year. Remember that?
Definitely. Yes, yeah. I do.
So Princeton is probably going to move on. They're 16-6 on the year and 9-0 in conference play. And the Ivy League does have a tournament this year, guys. So it's going to be pretty interesting to watch that moving on here, Dream.
Keep that in mind as far as your tournament is concerned. Also, VCU gets the job done last night against the Richmond Spiders. That was one of my calls. That I stole from Dr. Danis. Dr. Danis turned me on to VCU. Been keeping a little bit of eye on this VCU team. VCU, though, has historically, for me, punched me in the face.
Yeah, they go on the road and lose these tight games, and it kind of just pisses you off. You know what I'm saying? I know exactly where you're going with that.
But I am watching them this year. They have been great in certain spots. I have gotten on board. Last night was a nice was a nice job by them beating Richmond 84-73. So we will keep an eye on them moving forward. Like I said, that's one of Dr. Dan's seems to be one of his little undercover teams, and I kind of jumped on board on that bandwagon. Stanford beats Cal last night. That one I did not see coming. I did like Cal in that particular matchup. Stanford gets it done 73-68 at home against Cal. Cal could get nothing going in this game, it seemed like. You know, Stanford jumped out, got the lead, went at the half up four, came back out, was able to sustain a couple of runs that Cal tried to pull on them, but Stanford still was able to overcome it. Good job by them winning in their house. Bad job by Cal not getting that win on the road against a team that they should have beat.
Well, you know what? Cal actually jumped out to the lead in the beginning of the game where Stanford was super cold.
What I'm saying is Stanford went in at the half up four.
Yeah, right. But what, like the first, I would say maybe 5 to 10 minutes of the game, Stanford couldn't buy a shot.
Okay.
At all. It was nasty to watch. And I actually thought your Cal play was going to come to fruition, but sure enough, they ended up just letting Stanford come back, climb back. And
they made a little run at the end, but it just wasn't, you know, it didn't seem to be enough to get it done.
No, not at all. So, but anyway, hey, you know what? It was a light card last night because the card is a monster today, Dream.
Well, of course, Saturday's a big day for college basketball. We know that. We talked about that, you know, going down. We're going to get to that in a second. Really quick, let's just recap the ice 1 second as the Colorado Avalanche last night did get a win. I've talked about the Colorado Avalanche being horrible, and they beat the Hurricanes. And I said yesterday, I hated the Hurricanes too. So I said, don't be bothered with that game. The Blue Jackets beat the Penguins. That's an interesting win. This Columbus team, I cannot wager with this team. I don't know why. I bet with them, they lose. I bet against them, they win. So I stayed away from that. And I would have liked the Penguins to beat them anyway. I like the Penguins a lot more than the Blue Jackets, so glad I didn't touch that. Panthers beat the Ducks. We talked about the Ducks getting their forward suspended for 10 games. Panthers go in there last night and beat them 4-1. That's an interesting win for the Panthers and a bad loss for the Ducks at their house. We may have to keep an eye on the Ducks moving forward until they get their forward back. As far as they're just not being able to score.
Got it.
And that's pretty much all I got for hockey as far as the recap of last night. We got a little bit of hockey going on today that we're going to take a look at a little bit later in the show. But without further ado, we might want to get right into this college hoop.
I think we're going to need to have a conversation because I'm already seeing some spots that are kind of just sticking right out at me, Dream.
Okay.
And you know what? I'm just looking forward to it. So what I'm going to do is switch this up as we get ready to rock. And I'm going to let you lead off and see if you've got anything up your sleeve. You got any early stuff?
Well, what we're going to do is, why don't we run through the top 25, not all of them. Let's run through the top 10 real quick.
Okay.
Just talk about the matchups for a second, and then we can get into talking about, you know, exactly what we like as far as plays and what's concerned to, later on tonight.
All right, sounds good. Well, the first one you got is number 25, Notre Dame at NC State. Notre Dame is -5 after the big win last week, Dream.
Big win last week. NC State, not a good team this season. NC State, you and I talked about NC State, like a week and a half ago?
Yes.
Yeah, we talked about this NC State team. You know, has it been good this season? Notre Dame, no, man. You know, Notre Dame shows you signs of life.
Yeah.
Looks like they're going to flourish. Just when you get excited about them and think they're going to get it done, they get that booty loss.
I know. And you know what? That's the thing. But Dream, who is that not apropos to discuss about in any team? Every single team is going to sneak you at that bad time. They're going to just have that bad loss. I don't care if you're the top team in the country. Well, can't say that for Gonzaga this year. But
I don't mind a bad loss if it's tight. Okay? If the score is tight, I don't mind a loss. Okay? When you let Virginia beat you 71-51, 55-54. I'm struggling with that. That's a bad loss, okay? And that's also a bad loss in your house.
Well, especially the way Virginia's been playing.
especially the way Virginia has no offense. You know, other losses aren't so bad as they did lose to, you know, Villanova. They lost to Purdue. They lost to Florida State, who I think is a good quality team. The other scratch your head is the Georgia Tech loss.
Well, Georgia Tech has been my undercover dream.
Okay.
You know, I'm kind of feeling this team, to be honest with you. I mean, they beat the hell out of Florida State.
But for Notre Dame, you know, and what they're trying to do, you know, those are losses that bother me. This is an important game for them as far as I'm concerned. Notre Dame needs to go out there and get this game. From a monetary standpoint, though, not getting involved in this.
I get it.
Not
getting
involved with this.
It's tough. Just having them on the road after an emotional win, tough, man. I'm not doing it. No way. No
way. The outlook for today and the theme of today is going to be, and my theme on Saturdays is going to be, I'm really not getting involved with road teams on Saturday playing college basketball.
I don't blame you.
Not doing it.
That's in any collegiate sport for me all the time. I hate taking road teams unless it's a team that I know is absolutely far superior. I'm not doing it.
Even still, I mean, there's a couple of spots that I absolutely love today as far as road situations are concerned. But based on what I've seen in weeks past and what's going down, I'm just not messing with the road today. I'm just not going to do it. I don't want a headache and a stomachache today. So road wagering today on college basketball is not going down because there's enough home stuff that I can pass up the road.
Number two, Villanova. 12:30 goes into Seton Hall. Villanova is 25-2 on the year, 12-2 in the Big East. Both of their losses have come in conference. 16-9 Seton Hall team, and Nova is on the road, a 7-point favorite. What you got there?
And once again, like I just said, I'm not messing with a road. I'm not getting involved with the road. The road is a wrap, gang. I'm not messing with the road today. I do like Villanova to beat Seton Hall. Seton Hall is going to be pesty as hell, though.
Yeah,
understand
I know.
That.
Yep.
They're going to be pesty as hell. They're in their house. They're going to want to defend what they do. If you talk to my boy Irvin, who loves the Big East, hit him up out there. He'll give you some thoughts on the Big East and how he feels about this particular matchup. I like Villanova to win, but I'm not betting on it.
Wake Forest, 15-11 on the year, 6-8 in the ACC going into the Dukies to play the 21-5, number 12 ranked Duke. Duke is minus 12.5, under over 159. And Dream, I really feel that Duke's lines are going to start getting super inflated. And I think this is too many points for them to be given.
I agree. Duke's lines always are super inflated.
Yeah,
that's
right.
Historic for the last, since Coach K's been there. They always got an inflated line.
Right.
And I don't disagree with you that today's line is inflated. However, Wake Forest is booty.
No, they're not.
I don't like Wake Forest hat.
They're not that bad, Dream.
Hat, they're 15-11.
Yeah,
6-8 in the ACC.
They're a better than 500 team. They play in the ACC, Dream. Come on.
They don't have a winning record in the ACC hat.
Okay.
They don't.
Look who they're playing.
At Wake Forest. Duke already beat Wake Forest, by the way, too, already.
By how much?
They lost to Clemson. Listen.
They beat them by 2 points, Dream.
You're not selling me to Wake Forest.
I'm taking Wake Forest plus 12.5. I don't see Duke covering this. As a matter of fact, Duke is a sub-500 team against the spread at home. I'm taking Wake Forest. I'm taking the 12.5.
Because the spreads have been completely ridiculous.
Exactly. Perfect.
Hat.
I'm on it.
Don't bet against Duke today.
All right. Well, you know what? I'm going to
go
on the
Duke
island
today.
All by myself.
They're feeling their swagger. They've gotten a few wins under their belts. They got a lot of momentum going on right now. That place is going to be absolutely crazy. It's a 1 o'clock start. Coach K is going to have his boys ready. Wake Forest doesn't travel well. They don't play that great on the road. Wake Forest, it does not play good in the ACC as they're 6-8. Duke is going to beat Wake Forest, and I would not be surprised if they cover, but I'm not wagering on it.
Little small money line on Shaky Wake today. I'm going to get some Wake Forest and be a hero tomorrow. That's what I'm looking at, Dream. So
be the hero. We don't need another hero hat. We need a winning play. Okay? You gave us Yale last night.
Shut up. That was my own personal little light.
You gave us the under in the Golden State Nuggets game. We don't need no more heroism.
Yeah, but I've been giving you Monmouth like every single day they play, and they've been murdering stuff.
Stick with Monmouth.
All right. 1 o'clock, we got Vatech going into number 8 Louisville. Louisville is 21-5 at full strength on the year. Minus 12.5 Louisville is, Dream, at home. I'm sure this is a perfect spot for you.
perfect spot for me, but I'm not getting involved in. I do like Louisville, but Louisville's been very erratic this season, especially in covering spreads. Now, you talk about an inflated line. It's 12.5 is kind of heavy as far as I'm concerned for Louisville. However, the one number that you might want to look at, the over and under total on this game is 144.5, and I do like this game to go under. Louisville likes to slow you down, run their half-court sets. I think they'll have some effectiveness doing that with Virginia Tech. I don't really love Virginia Tech's perimeter shooting. I think they're, you know, I think they're a pretty good team. You'll know more about this Virginia Tech team than I do. You mess with them a little bit more than me.
Well, you know what? They just had the big win over Virginia.
Right.
And they are 18-7 on the year.
Sure.
You know what? This might be a tight one.
Yeah, I think this game's going to be a tight one. I do think Louisville's given too many points. Now, this game, I wouldn't mind you taking the 12 points, unlike that Wake Forest game. But I do think that the one thing you need to watch in this game, I think that Louisville's going to slow this thing down with their defense. I do think Virginia Tech's going to have some problems with perimeter shooting. I think Louisville has a little bit of an advantage as far as the boards are concerned. Also, the guard play of Louisville is a little bit better. Donovan Mitchell, you know, having a very good season, very competent season. Coached up the right way. I like Louisville in this spot, but I like the under in this game more. Under 45.5, I like more than I like the game, but I'm not playing this game. Keep that in mind, gang.
Do you realize that Louisville is 10-3 against the spread at home this year? They cover
10-3. That's 10-3.
Yeah, definitely. So,
but they haven't had huge spreads.
Yep.
You know, it's not like the Duke spreads. I've seen Duke with some ridiculous spreads, and I'm like, come on, man. Because it's Duke.
Number 3, Kansas at number 4, Baylor. Baylor minus 2, Dream.
Okay, and this is the huge matchup right here today. And a lot of people, I believe, are going with Kansas today to beat this Baylor team. I'm not discrediting that. And I definitely see that. I see a reason for it. I get it. I understand. I don't love Baylor. I know you don't like him either.
No.
But I don't like Bill Self. And okay. I don't like, and I think Kansas is okay, but you've told me yourself, you think Kansas is a bit overrated.
Yeah, they are. They are. I think they had a better team last year. Last year was their shot. And I just don't see it this year, to be honest with you, Dream. I just don't. And you know what? I mean, looking at it here, it is a big matchup in the Big 12, obviously. And Kansas can all but clinch its 13th straight conference championship by winning at Baylor on Saturday. Nice. Lot to play for today.
You know, it's hard to call this game. I think this game is a watcher. You know, I mean, if you guys want to play a marquee matchup, then, I mean, this is it. But
there's no way. You couldn't pay me to put my money on this.
Right, but you're going to take Wake Forest. Anyway.
I'm taking Wake Forest. Plus 12.5. I don't like Duke at all.
Jordan. I cannot wait to send you to Cry to Jordan for getting down with Wake when they're up, when they're down 20 at that. Actually, you'd be happy then for them to be down 20 at the half all because right. College basketball teams love to blow big leads.
Yeah, of course, exactly.
But we will definitely have to discuss the outcome of that game later. Anyway, back to this Baylor Kansas game. Gang, I don't like the game. I don't like the matchup. I don't like Kansas on the road, and I don't like Baylor at home. So I don't see a reason to get involved with wagering on this game. If I had to gun to my head, I think I would take Kansas, but I don't like Kansas, and there's better games as far as I'm concerned today.
I totally understand that, Dream. The next one I got up here is looking at number 15, Florida, who is 21-5 on the year, 11-2 in the SEC, going into 14-11 Mississippi State, and Florida is minus 10.5 on this particular game. And you know what? I've been watching this Florida team. I do like this Florida team a lot, Dream. The problem is now that their center is out for the season with a knee injury.
Sure.
And you know what? This, however you pronounce his name, Egbunu.
Okay.
Egbunu is gone. And that's a problem. That's their whole nucleus right there, man. So this team, I think, is going to... The 10.5. It could be tough. I'm not going anywhere near it. I gotta see how they play without this guy.
All right, so now when you talk about the loss of the center... Did you figure out how to pronounce his name?
Egbunu.
Igbuno. All right. Igbuno. When you talk about the loss of the center, 22 minutes he's averaging. As far as points, he's giving you 7.8 points a game.
It's the boards.
And the boards, rebounds, he's giving you six boards a game. I mean, that's not killer. I mean, you want double digit boards. I get you're going to miss his presence and he's gone, but you know, we can fall back for a little bit that. Now, he's a 6'11 center, Igbuno, okay? They also have Gak, who's also 6'11 as well, and they got Rimmer at 6'10. So, you're talking about, they do have the ability for these guys to step up and step into this spot and up play their gameplay. I don't know that this is going to, for today's matchup, I don't know that the loss of Igbuno is gonna really significantly impact this game, because I think that the other athletes are gonna be able to step in here and handle their business as far as the boards are concerned. You know what my problem is with this game? The spread.
Yeah, it's a lot. It's a lot.
You know,
the road.
10 points is ridiculous as far as I'm concerned.
Well,
for them,
Florida's been a covering machine, bro.
They have been a covering machine, but like you said, you take out their center in this game, and the point spread is still at 10.5.
Yeah.
And you're like, come on, give me a break.
I know. You got number 9 West Virginia hosting Texas Tech today. You know, West Virginia's minus 12 with Huggy Hugs at the helm here, and Texas Tech is 17-9 on the year. Dream. Problem is they can't win in the Big 12. They're 5-8 in the Big 12. This is
all right, so hold on 1 second, because I want to go back to a point with the Florida-Mississippi State game.
Yep.
If you can get Florida in an 8-point teaser better, and I happen to like the 10-pointer, gang, for basketball, I like working with a 10-point tease. If I'm going to do a tease, you know I don't like teasers in basketball. But if you get a 10-point tease, which you're going to have to get four to five teams in to make it somewhat reasonable as far as the payout is concerned, I do like Florida in this spot if you can get rid of their 10 points.
I thought you're not taking any road teams.
This is a recommendation. I'm not getting involved with it because it's a road game. But Florida is a lot better than Mississippi State, in my opinion. And I do think that their big men will be able to step up. And like Hat said, Florida has been a covering machine this season. And the other thing is, because Florida knows that they've lost their big man, this is a game that I think that the coaching staff is going to have them up to play, saying we've got to win these games right now. We don't have the luxury to drop a game here that we should win, just for moving forward as far as your tournaments are concerned. So I do like Florida. I'm not playing it. Remember this, I'm not playing it. But if you're getting involved, get rid of the 10 points. I think you're going to be okay.
What are you, son? What are you? Number 9, Press Virginia, as we talked about earlier, giving 12 points to Texas Tech. Could be a little bit of an interesting matchup. This could be a little tighter than that 12, Dream.
Could be a little bit tighter than that 12. This team right here and this game right here is a very interesting game to me. I like West Virginia in this spot. They're home, coming off the loss against Kansas. They did fight hard in that Kansas game. They did beat Kansas State. They did beat Oklahoma, which Oklahoma's no big deal. I don't even know why I even mentioned that. But they did beat Kansas when they played them before, 85-69. I like West Virginia in this spot. I don't like this Texas Tech team. I don't think that they're going to be that good today. I like Kansas. I like West Virginia to win this game.
All right. I mean, you got a couple of pretty decent defenses here. You know, when you take a look at that, and the total is 142.5. You know, the thing is, Press Virginia knows how to score buckets, man. So, you know what? Just be careful with that one. I mean, when you look at them, they're averaging, Dream, almost 86 points a game. Damn.
They are. And now keep West Virginia to the side and put an asterisk next to it, because we're going to bring them up a little bit later in the show and we give out the exact plays that I'm on.
They're winning their games by an average of 19.23 points per game. Press Virginia.
No doubt.
Pretty impressive. Let's move on. Do you have any interest in them in the tournament?
I don't, because Hugs just never can
Huggy
get it done.
Hugs, kid. Here's an interesting game, and I know you love the pack. Number 7, Oregon, is hosting Colorado. Colorado's 16-11 on the year, 6-8 in the Pac-12, and Oregon's 23-4, 12-2 in the Pac. Oregon, Dream, minus 11.5 points. Colorado is not a bad team. What do you got?
Not a bad team, but you're not coming into the Ducks and doing nothing with this Oregon team. Dylan Brooks is not having it. 6'7 forward, averaging 23 points. 15 points a game and 23 minutes a game out there on the court. I love this Oregon team, especially in this spot at home. It's a 3 o'clock Eastern Standard start. Put an asterisk next to this game. This is another part of the 10-point T selection that I've picked out for today. I like Oregon to get this done. The only problem that I see with Oregon is slightly, very slightly undersized. They're big with they're kind of regular size with their forwards. Their guards are slightly undersized, and they lack a little bit of size, which Colorado may be able to exploit that tightly. However, I think Oregon's transition game and the ability to get the ball up and down the court, it's going to prove to be the big difference there, along with being at home. I got Oregon winning this game. Keep it to the side. We're going to add that with West Virginia. That's part two of the 10-point teaser.
You know what? I like it to a certain extent, but the thing is that this Colorado team, I think, is better than you think.
No, they are.
And the seventh-ranked Ducks are 16-0 at home this season. And they're rocking a stretch of 41 consecutive dreams.
Not being Oregon in their house, Colorado, and especially not Colorado.
It's definitely tough. Moving on here, let's see what else we got as far as ranked games. We got number 16, your favorite team, Purdue, the Boilermakers, hosting Sparty. Michigan State 16-10, and Purdue is -9.5 with an under-over of 140.5, brother. I have not watched any Purdue this year. None so far. None at all.
Well, Purdue's still back in their sport and size. I mean, we know they had size last year. They got size this year. They got a 7'2 center. Isaiah Haas is doing his thing down there, down low. He's a big man. Swanigan is handling the boards impressively. Now, you talk about a boards machine. He's averaging 13 boards a game, a minimum. This Purdue team is somewhat, to me, impressive. But the only reason I say somewhat, it's because you and I both know how Purdue punched me in the face.
Oh, God. That was the worst to Little Rock.
I was all over Purdue and got punched in the face last year. I like this Purdue team. They're impressive. Now, look, Michigan State, very young team this year. Not really good on the road this year. Purdue should have their way with Michigan State. I mean, the post game should not even be questionable.
I know.
Purdue definitely should have their way, and Purdue is definitely going to want to step on the gas if they get them. However, guess what? You know how we like to do here? Line manipulation. There is absolutely no reason we need to give the 9.5, even though I do like Purdue at home, and they probably will cover the 9.5.
Yeah, that's tough.
Number three team in the 10-point tees.
All right. And last time Michigan State played Purdue, Miles Bridges had 33 points, the freshman. You know what? They might be zeroing in on him and getting this game a lot, getting a chokehold on Michigan State this time, Dream. I could see it. I can see them dominating them, to be honest with you, but I don't like the game.
Michigan State relies on Ward a lot, either forward, and I just think that Purdue's size is going to definitely cancel out what Ward is going to be able to do effectively. I'm trying to see a way Michigan State wins this game. I mean, obviously, you guys know anything can happen, as we've seen over in the world of sports time and time and again, but Purdue looks like a solid play to me, especially at home, and especially if you can get rid of the 9.5 points.
Number 17, Florida State is going into a very tough place to play in Pittsburgh. They're -5.5. Pittsburgh is 14-12 on the year, but they are 3-10 in conference play. Dr. Dizzle was on Pitt last week, and he won.
I don't know. Florida State team, you know, I like them, but it has been, you know, they've had their road issues, okay? Mm-hmm. You know, they lost to Notre Dame, and I know Notre Dame, you know, Notre Dame's good, but they lost Notre Dame on the road. They lost to Syracuse on the road. They lost to Georgia Tech on the road. They lost to North Carolina on the road.
Yeah, and they got crushed.
They've had road issues on this team. I don't know what their problem is on the road, but they have not played very well on the road. And you need them to come to town and come to play today. It's a 4 o'clock game start. They are at Pitt. I mean, Pitt is not a juggernaut. You know, Pitt's not a juggernaut. And this Florida State team is extremely, extremely talented. But what you worry about Florida State is you worry about them on the road because they've shown inability to execute and get it done on the road in their road situations, which is why I would stay away from this game.
Yeah, I mean, Florida State is clearly the better team on paper. But
clearly,
when you get this Pittsburgh team at home, anything could happen.
And Pittsburgh 3-10 in the ACC. So, I mean, they have been, you know, they have been beat up on by the other teams in the ACC, which Florida State should be able to do that. And you're talking about a Florida State team that's dropped in rankings because they've lost games on the road. They definitely should have won. Dwayne Bacon, the point guard's dynamic. They've got a lot of elements of what we've seen be successful over the course of the years in the NCAA and the NCAA tournament. But if you can't win on the road, you know, you're just not going to go anywhere because you're not playing in the tournament on the road.
No, sure.
I mean, at home.
Yeah, at home, you're not playing. That's for sure.
You know?
Hey, thoughts and prayers out to a couple of fallen wrestlers. George the Animal Steel and Ivan Koloff have both died, Dream.
Wow. Yeah, I did see the George the Animal Steel death. One of our nation, one of the guys in SPTV Nation had sent something out on a tweet, so I did see that. But I wasn't aware of Ivan Koloff as well.
Yeah, definitely. So Fast Eddie just sent me that, along with some beautiful photos, and I appreciate that very much. The number one team in the country, who is 27-0, number one Gonzaga, is playing Pacific, and they're given 29 points. Is there any way Pacific scores some buckets and has a backdoor cover here, Jerry?
No idea.
Come on, you watch Pacific all the time, don't you?
Yeah, I do. I love Pacific. They're incredible. No idea. And I just, Gonzaga's number one ranking, and every week, every time I watch them play, I just shake my head.
Really?
Yeah, because, I mean, they're just playing nobodies.
I don't know. You know what? This team's scoring almost 86 points a game. Defensively, they've stepped up their game tremendously. Even Weeby said that the other day. You know what? For some reason, Dream, you're going to hate this. I don't think they cover 29.
I am hating it. And I don't know why you're playing around with this. But here's my thing. This is what I want to ask you, okay? Because you think Gonzaga's good, and everybody thinks Gonzaga's awesome. Dude, let me ask you this. If you take the top 10 teams in the NCAA right now, the top 10 ranked teams in NCAA, and you put them in Gonzaga's division, do you think that they'd have the same record Gonzaga has? Because I do.
Maybe. I think a lot of them screw around a lot.
You put Villanova in Gonzaga's division. You don't think Villanova's undefeated?
Yeah, I think so. I think you're right there. Very good point. But I think teams like Kansas and Baylor and Huggy Hugs would lose a game.
Huggy Hugs, because his hug, that's what he does. He's like a Geico commercial. He just loves to lose a game.
I really think so. I think Baylor would have two losses already.
By the way, I also am going to go out on the line and say this. Put Duke there, and I think Duke would be undefeated.
Duke would lose to the Dons. All right. 6 o'clock, number 13, Killer Calipari in Kentucky. 21-5 on the year going into Georgia, and they're -7.5. Ooh, that's an ugly game, Dream.
They
huh?
can't get it together. He can't figure out how to get them kids. He can't reach these kids this year from what I've seen. You know, there's flashes of they look like they're going to be good, and then all of a sudden there's regression. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They haven't been that great on the road for most of this season. And as far as covering spreads.
I know. I have no interest in that whatsoever.
You know, you lose to Tennessee on the road, which is ridiculous as far as I'm concerned. You lose on the road to Louisville. Not bad because Louisville's a good team. I get that. You also lost to UCLA. That's not bad. UCLA is a good team. But this team, they just don't cover their spreads. They get involved with tight. You know what they do? Here's what they do. They play to their opponent's ability. That's what they do.
Got it.
Right. You know, I know they came back and they beat Tennessee when they got them at home. Because somebody's probably going to say, "Well, they beat Tennessee when they came home." Yeah, but you should have never lost to Tennessee just because you were on the road.
They've had that though, Dream. They do that to you.
I know.
They did it last year to me. I remember they went and played Auburn and lost, and I was like, "Come on, man, really?" But it is what it is, and it happens. So, hey, I have no interest in them. Any other Kentucky comments before we move on?
No more Kentucky comments. I don't think this Kentucky team's going to go far this year. I don't really like the way they play. There's a lot of inconsistency. And defensively, I don't like them defensively at all.
Number 19, SMU Ski is going into Houston, Dream. Houston
18-7.
And SMU is -2.
Saw this game. road situation, not getting involved, but I did see this game. This SMU team, you know, they haven't gotten a lot of looks and they haven't gotten talked about a lot. They've been quietly just handling their business, 13-1 in their conference, which doesn't say a whole hell of a lot because it's like being undefeated in Gonzaga's conference. But they've gone out and handled their business and won the games they were supposed to win, so I guess we've got to pay them a little bit of attention there. As far as Houston's concerned, 18-7 on the season. They've got a dynamic guard in Rob Gray getting it done out there, 20.5 points a game he's averaging. It's going to be an interesting game. I don't think SMU is going to walk in that
Houston
Arena and blow them right out the doors. It's going
to
be a tight game because it's got stomach ache, you know, written all over it.
Oh, big time. Huge.
I think SMU, though, does win the game, but I'm not going to take it because, like I said, I'm not doing any road work today and not getting involved.
All right. I got to break away 1 second from college basketball and ask Weaver if this is true. Cleveland NFL News has agreed in principle to send the number one overall pick to New England for Jimmy Garoppolo. The number one pick in the draft, Dream, the defending Super Bowl champions. Has that ever happened?
I don't know. And where'd you get that information from?
Weaver just sent it to me.
Oh, okay.
That's from Adam Schefter. Wow. That could be interesting, guys. If that really is the case, damn. Imagine it, the defending champions with the number one pick in a draft, Dream. Damn. I don't think that's ever happened. I can't remember in any years past where that's happened. Hmm. That's how dope the New England Patriots are, to be honest with you. To trade their backup for a number one pick. And you know what? The Miami Dolphins should do that too with Matt Mizzi. I'm dead serious. They should be the number two pick. Moving on here, Dream. Number five, Arizona going into Washington. Washington is 9-17 on the year. This is your Arizona team, 24-3. A road team, Dream. Minus nine. Let's hear if you're going to backtrack your
I am not. And you know it's killing me because I do love this Arizona team, and I think Arizona wins hands down. They're big. They've got everything talked about them most of the season. But guess what? I said the theme today was home teams. I'm not messing around with the road. So Arizona, I'm sorry. While I love you to death and I think you're going to win, I'm not getting involved in Arizona because I've got some other stuff that I'm doing. And as we're at that time, you know, let's get into some of the stuff that I am doing.
All right, let's do it, man.
First of all, straight play.
Straight play.
Straight play. Terrence Mack, brace yourself.
Oh.
As I'm going Carolina blue. Straight play, Carolina baby blue. I like North Carolina against Virginia. This Virginia team this season, it looks like they are, I don't know, free-falling and can't catch themselves. Guess what? A bad time to be free-falling and coming in to playing this North Carolina team. North Carolina's going to throw at you all their size. They're averaging about about 6'9 and a half in the forward position, and you're coming at you with a 6-foot guard. I like North Carolina's guards. I like their transition basketball. They are at home. They do need this spot. I think this is going to be a great win for them. What Virginia likes to do, I think, plays right into this North Carolina team's hands. I expect to see North Carolina be able to get the ball movement in transition. I don't think Virginia's going to be able to stop them. I don't think Virginia's going to be able to out-rebound them in this game. Virginia's going to want to look to try to get physical with them, and I don't think they're going to be successful there. I got North Carolina on a straight play. What are you at the minus at? I got a minus five. Minus five. I like North Carolina to win. I like him in a straight play. I'm going to take North Carolina. I'm going to back that up, gang, with 10-point teaser. I've already gave you a couple elements of the teaser, and that is West Virginia, minus two. Oregon, minus 1.5. We've added Purdue to it, minus 0.5. And sorry, hold on one second.
Why wouldn't you do a money line parlay, just out of curiosity?
It didn't pay as well because I'm putting a few teams in. And some of those are minus like 1,200.
Oh, stupid. Got it.
And UCLA plus 0.5.
Sounds good, man. All right. So that's where you're at?
That is where I'm at as far as college basketball is concerned.
All right. For me, I'm going to start off with a stomach ache in the ACC right out the gate. And I'm going to take the U, Miami, in a Moneyline parlay to beat Clemson today. I am not a fan of this Clemson team at all. I know Blossom game has been decent for Clemson, but you know what? I think Miami comes to play. It's going to be a stomachache, but I think for the most part that they win the game. I'm not giving the 4 points because Miami cannot cover spreads at all, but I'm going to take them in a Moneyline parlay to get the job done. I'm also going to take Wake Forest plus the 12.5. I don't think Duke covers that. I think Wake Forest is an underrated team. I really do. And they are in a very tough conference, but I think they're going to get it done. And I like Wake Forest today as well. Moving over, I'm going to take Mercer Madness Dream. They're on the road, but they're playing the Citadel. Citadel in conference play is 2-12 in the Southern. Mercer's -7. Get rid of the points. I'm taking Mercer Madness on the road. They're playing a far inferior team. Those are my two so far, being the U and being Mercer Madness. And I'm looking at the rest of the slate, and I just don't see a lot that's jumping out at the page at me, to be honest with you. So those are my plays, Dream.
All right.
So my money's going to come kind of early.
Money's going to come early. Nothing wrong with early money.
No, not at all. So do you have anything else up your sleeve?
I don't, but I had one more spot, and I have it written down. And for some reason, in my notes here, I don't really understand what it is, which makes no sense. I know, right?
What this the
makes
hell no is sense. That?
I was trying to look for it while you were talking, and I still haven't found it. So if I figure it out where I was going at, I will definitely tweet it out to you guys later. I am really Oklahoma State.
I thought it was Incarnate Word.
I'm sorry. No, it's Oklahoma State. You can add Oklahoma State to that 10-point teaser. You guys know I tend to like four teams. You can get involved in my opinion, 5. I do like Oklahoma State to beat Oklahoma, and you'd have Oklahoma State -1.5 as well. Oklahoma State, I like them to beat Oklahoma today. That's why I couldn't figure it out. Okay.
All right. Sounds good, man.
I got it. As far as the hockey's concerned, we'll move over to the ice real briefly and real quickly for a second. And guys, this is not a big play. It's not a strong play. It's going to be very weak because I am going to give my San Jose Sharks a little bit of a shot tonight. They are going up against the Coyotes. Now they're on the road. Talked about not quite the same on the road situations as college basketball. This is a little bit different as we're talking about hockey. San Jose Sharks, I told you they are in a little bit of a slump, but I am hopefully in that they are ready to get out of that slump right now. They're playing the Coyotes. I think they can win this game. I'm going easy. I'm recommending everybody else go easy. I'm taking the Sharks, and I'm money-lining them with the Montreal Canadiens. Canadiens are playing the Jets. It's a 2 o'clock start in the Canadian game, an 8 o'clock start in the Shark game. So we'll take a look at the Canadiens at 2 o'clock. I like a money-line parlay with these two teams. Very, very light, very, very easy, as I'm trying to figure out if the Sharks are ready to get back to winning ways.
They might be. Might be a pretty good spot. I still like them as one of the best.
They're very good. Definitely. This team's good. But you know how we talked about those, you know, peaks and valleys, and they seem to be in that valley right now.
All right, Dream. And you know what? I'm kind of going against the grain a little bit as far as taking a road team with Mercer Madness, but I'm doing it because I think this team is going to get it done versus the booty Citadel. So that's it, Dream.
That's
going to do it for us. What do you got to do to close out of here, my man?
So one more time, gang. North Carolina straight. I like North Carolina -5. I think they get it done against this Virginia team as Virginia's free falling. So we're going to take advantage of that, and they are home. Then it's the 10-point tees. It's all home teams. It's West Virginia. It's Oregon. It's Purdue. It's Oklahoma State and UCLA. You can add or remove any one of those if you don't like to run with the 5, whichever one you feel is most volatile. Get them out of that teaser. But I think all of those are very solid, especially in that teaser situation. And then there's the money line parlay with the Montreal Canadiens and the San Jose Sharks. That's going to do it for us. I want to thank everybody that's out there retweeting the show. JDH24, my boy Terrence Mack, North Carolina faithful. Jeff Ryan's in the house. What's going on? AB Lent, Mark Edwards, Spot Bet, Jim Rome's a douche, Fast Eddie 72. Good to see my boy Sebastian out there. Benjamin Rowe as well. G Rose, Michael Mosca's in the house. My boy Scott Weaver, always being a positive additive to this program. Jay Beezy's World of Picks. What's going on? LBCC, Alvin Duckworth, Vegas Girl 92661. Shane Whitehead is out there as well. We also have my boy Irvin, Cash Action Bets, Direct Sport Solution, OJFB, just to name a few. Gang, I think we've got a little treat prepared for you tomorrow. I've worked on some things. I've worked on a little bit of a extra additive for the show that I'm looking for, and I hope it's going to be a little bit entertaining as far as tomorrow's concerned. However, I am waiting for a confirmation, which I have not gotten.
Oh, you're waiting for, you know what, you got somebody nervous to come on. That's the problem. That is the problem.
I am waiting for a confirmation. I did not get the confirmation. I thought I had it all set. That's when I put out the information. I thought I'd be able to unveil it today on the show. However, I did not get a confirmation. I'm waiting on that. As soon as I get it, I'll give you guys a little bit of info on it on Twitter. We'll tweet something out, and then hopefully you guys can catch it in tomorrow's show. Gang, we love you to death. Go easy today. I'm the Dream. Always remember who you're with and make the most of each and every day, as you cannot get this time back.
Right on, because I'm supposed to be on a hot seat tomorrow, so I'm still kind of waiting to hear what's going to pop with that Dream. So, guys, this is where I'm at. Miami University, Mercer Madness, and I'm taking Wake Forest plus 12.5. Do whatever it is you got to do in life to do whatever it is you want to do and get that money. Let's go!